confusion. We had a few members of the budget subcommittee that could not make 6 o'clock. I personally could not make 6 o'clock. It was senior day for track, and my son is a senior, and unfortunately, you know, I'm going to go see my son first, so I watched him participate in his final track meet of the year, so I apologize for that. But that being said, we're going to take a couple things out of order. First and foremost, though, I do want to introduce Travis. Travis is our newest member. How do you pronounce your last name, Travis?
Matheson.
Matheson. Okay. So just like it's okay. It's spelled. I thought there. I got it from Phil, so I wasn't sure if really you just spelled it wrong. Or, so Travis won the second spot in Westbrook Field. Congratulations. You do have to get sworn in, you know, to vote, but you can still participate in the conversation. If you just want to real quick, just kind of give everybody, you know, who you are, what you do, why you joined the school committee, you know, 30 seconds. And
sure. I'm Travis Matheson from West Brookfield. I am a graduate of Quaboag in 2001. I have two sons that are in the West Brookfield elementary system now, so that's why I joined. And I look forward to serving on this committee.
Congratulations. And as I said to you today when we were talking, you know, The next 6 months to a year, you're going to be drinking from the fire hydrant. But we have a lot of members of this committee that have been around for a while, and you know, I'm sure we'll be more than happy to answer any questions that you have that come up. I think we'll take we'll do the stuff that Chris has, because I know Chris, you have another engagement that you have to be at. So. Being told is What I find very interesting is the other district that Warren is a member of, Pathfinder, is still in the omnibus budget. So, you know, this is definitely a, I don't know, a choice that the town has made to, you know, single out the Quaboag Regional School District. Legal counsel says it's not illegal. I find it unethical. It's very interesting that this is the path that, you know, the select board of stating how transparent they're going to be has decided to go. Towns have their meetings, you know, they go through their meetings, you know, if all three numbers match, we then go back and we approve the budget that the towns have proposed, and we have a budget for the next year. With Warren making the changes that they're making, which would pretty much come to, you know, West Brookfield's portion, they have to match it because it's a district number, and it goes based on enrollment. Would be probably a cut of close to $1 million out of our budget. If Warren votes the number that they've proposed and West Brookfield votes a different number that they feel is adequate to the school budget, you know, that's a no vote on Warren. It comes back to the school committee. The school committee can either approve the West Brookfield portion and then it goes back to Warren, and Warren's going to have to hold another town meeting to, you know, either ratify their number or, you know, we end up going to a district meeting. If the school committee doesn't agree on either town's budget, we can vote a no vote to the budget, and then that basically goes to a district meeting. So it's not the end of the world. I know a lot of people have come up to me over the past couple of days and said, the town's going to, you know, it's going to decimate the school. Well, it's yes in theory, but it comes down to the townspeople. It comes down to the taxpayers. I'm a taxpayer in the town of Warren. I know Jay's a taxpayer in the town of Warren. You know, the members of the committee that live in Warren are obviously taxpayers. So the fact that the town has decided to take that right to vote away from us rubs me the wrong way, but it's not the end of the world. So,
Chris, do you have the number? He said around a million. Do you know what the number would be if the number that was presented in the warrant would be the one that passes? Like,
how much
would we have to cut?
Let me see if I can. What were they talking about when the number was set up?
110. 110 above minimum.
Okay. So, Chris, you took the 110 and did the West Brookfield part of that and say they did it. That would give you what you really would have to cut.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's. Right now, just if I change the 110, that's assuming that West Brookfield is going to give their full amount. You want to keep that assumption?
Well, let's say, so if Warren does the 110, it's roughly, I mean, it's a 59-41 split, so 41% of the 110 would be probably 60-something, you know. So all set above minimum would probably be about a 170.
Oh, 175.
Yeah, 175. So that would be a cut of...
If just Warren changed the 110, we'd have to cut 1.1 million.
And Maureen, can I ask a question?
Yes.
I know that would be huge. I don't know if you have the concept now. What would that look like? Like, how would that be for the school? Like, from
case that on what you just said, you know, if you, if West Brookfield were to match that number, you know, based on my little back, you know, little math over here, we're talking a $1.9 million cut.
1.9.
Which I believe is half of the operating budget, approximately, of Warren Community Elementary School. So I think what Maureen Sanders absent spot on, you would have to go down to a 2-school district at that point. I don't think there'd be any option.
So, I do know we have a member of the audience from the Finance Committee. I don't know if they're here as a member of the Finance Committee or just as a resident of town, so I don't want to put them on the spot. If they're just here as a resident of the town, which they are here as a member of the Finance Committee. I know in looking through the articles of the town warrant, you know, either Finance Committee recommends or Finance Committee does not recommend. But for Article 10, there is no comment under the Finance Committee's either recommendation or not recommending. If the member of the Finance Committee is here, in fact, as a member of the Finance Committee wants to speak on that part, I'm going to ask that question at town meeting. But I'm just curious, you know, if the Finance Committee had any kind of, you know, any kind of thought on the change of this article. Sit as a board during town meeting, so I was just curious as to, you know, if they have a recommendation. Obviously, I'll ask that question tomorrow. So no worries. But yeah, I mean, if anybody has any, you know, questions or comments, you know, I'd be happy to entertain.
Just as, you know, the one thing that strikes me, I don't know if it's odd at this point or unexpected or maybe it should have been expected. The one thing that we did do this year during this school budget season that we did in the past that we kind of brought back this year was that constant kind of communication with the towns and having that meeting. When I say we started probably December timeframe and then a few throughout. And it was supposed to be a good back and forth, and it never got to that point. I mean, with having that conduit for the communication and not even being told about this type of situation, I don't know, it doesn't strike a transparent two-way conversation that we were hoping to have. So I find that extremely disappointing.
This article at town meeting.
So, Maureen, you had a conversation with the town administrator, right?
Yeah. So, the town administrator told me it's past practice, and therefore,
it's the reason that we're the United States of America today, because town people are not having a voice at town meeting. So that's like the fundamental purpose of a town meeting in Massachusetts, is to give the people who live in the town a voice.
Would the Robert's rules go into effect?
No, it's town meeting time, and it's specific to Massachusetts.
That's the procedures.
That's the procedures and the rules, and that is referenced in the town of Warren's bylaws. And as far as I can find, that would trump past practice, because that's what the bylaws said.
So, then another question would be, what happens if they vote it down?
So if Warren votes down, or if townspeople vote down the budget?
We don't want it. Would
so,
that be a win? That'd be a win.
It would, yeah, I mean, it would, I mean, it would be the same as basically voting a 110, you know, it would be same as voting this article in, because either way, I don't think the school committee is going to accept the vote. You know, I could be wrong, but, you know, I don't think that.
No, if they vote it, if they vote it down, then the school, there's no funding.
There's no funding.
No funding.
No
for
funding.
School.
It's not the same as 110, it's the same as no
zero.
Funding. $0.
But then I don't know what that does with the local contribution and.
If 110, it doesn't matter.
I'd be interested in legal counsel's opinion on that, on whether the town would be in violation of the district-wide agreement, because they have to fund the schools. If they vote no on a single article where the school is the only article on that article, they're in just by voting no, they're in violation of the entire agreement, and it all goes out the window. That's what they're putting on the line right now. I'm not legal counsel.
Right.
But.
You're going down the same path, are you?
Yeah.
Yes.
Because it's an all or nothing.
Yes.
It's not individual line items. It's not that. It's an all or nothing. Where if it's in the omnibus budget, there's some set number that has to be made, right? From that perspective.
Did all the parents say they voted down?
I'm
voting down.
I'm not a resident of Warren, but I would advocate for the residents of Warren to vote it down.
We'll
say no, let's see what happens.
Okay.
We'll definitely reach out to legal counsel, you know, in the morning and get an answer to that. But I tend to be in agreement as well. I mean, it's a violation of the regional agreement.
I have a couple other questions.
Yes, sir.
So we need legal counsel to determine whether residents can amend an article on the town floor. Pretty sure they can. I also would like legal counsel's opinion on how much weight past practice holds. Like, past practice doesn't necessarily mean anything to me. Unless there's something, is that binding? Does it become binding at some point? Is that in the agreement somewhere? What does past practice mean? It means nothing to me at this point. Couple more comments. So two building school districts. Kind of where we kind of round tabled this about 5-6 years ago, something like that. I think I was probably in the minority. I might have been the only school committee member with the opinion that we are a two building school district. And until the towns figure that out, we're gonna be in this situation. We're gonna be $1 million short every single year, because we're funding a three building district. We're funding a two district. We're funding a two building district as a three building district.
Well, we're funding a three building district with the population of two buildings.
There it is. So I still think we're a two building district. And I don't think this budget is ever going to work until we shut one of the buildings down. That being said, when we roundtable this 5 or 6 years ago, we figured out that we could make it work. It works. Is that still? Over here, would it still work potentially? I mean, enrollment hasn't gone up. If anything, has gone down.
I think you have to look at it very carefully in terms of which building, if you had to close a building, which building would you close?
Yep.
Because right now, hypothetically, Warren could house all of the students, but if you house it in Warren, then you lose your regional transportation, because now
that build, like how, like, that's a...
I think that has to be more feasibility study on it.
Yeah.
But if you look at it, if transportation is 1.5 million, right, and you're closing West Brookfield Elementary, you're now going to incur that $1.5 million, which is less than the above minimum contribution that the district's asking.
It doesn't sound like a problem that we're going to be able to solve in the next 4 to 5 months before
right.
the next school year starts.
But I don't know where you get $1.9 million. It's,
right.
You don't have $1 million worth of cuts.
Right.
I mean, I know that the town thinks that we have a lot of staff. We don't have a lot of staff. Like, $1 million, I don't know where you're going to get that money from. I think they have to have more conversations
about
that.
Cuts every year. I mean, I've been on the school committee for 8 or 9 years. I don't remember. A while. And we've had cuts every single year. We've cut at least a teacher or a librarian or paras or something every single year. We were talking about how we were bare bones 5 years ago, and we've made cuts since then. We're like less than we're like half a stack of bones at this point.
To piggyback on that, don't we have elementary school classrooms that are at their max or close to it? What is that, like 28 to 30 kids in an elementary school classroom? I can tell you as an educator, not a lot of learning happens in that room, no matter how hard or how good the teacher is. How are they trying?
So I think this is, we should really be looking at what is the total tax levy. And from what we would never find out, there is money there in this budget. So I don't know how we get that number. I mean, Chris was able to get a number online of $8,417,107. We fully understand that there's a cushion that a town has to have because things break, right? And we have to allow them to have that so that if something breaks, they have access to money. But it appears that there is money on this budget. So that's another question. Why don't the people that are, you know, in the selectman's role take a priority for schools and use the money that they do have in the tax levy?
So I went to the assessor's office and they actually responded to me and they said for fiscal year 23, the levy limit for Warren is $9,257,368. So it's even higher than yours. Yours might have been 22. Fiscal year 22 was $8,979. Is that what any of you have? That's coming from the assessor's office. I would assume they know what they're.
Well, that's the total levy. Maybe the levy limit is the 9.4 million, whatever you said.
9.2. Yeah. So, I think to Maureen's point, there is the spending is well below the levy limit. I do know that they reassess the housing values and they'll change the tax rate and everything like that. But I mean, my taxes went up $2,500. Multiply that by how many thousands of houses there are in the town of Warren, how much more money do they bring in real estate taxes? So, I mean, I think, to your point, there's money in the town. I believe this is just being done as a, a statement or whatever, but, as a school committee, I mean, our role as school committee members are to advocate for the kids in the district, That's why we're meeting tonight is to discuss the advocacy for the kids in this district that can't speak for themselves. So,
has the budget committee heard anything from West Brookfield as far as their thoughts on this? Nothing.
I didn't know if there was
any communication.
Though to be fair, I haven't reached out.
Okay.
They haven't reached us, and we haven't had a meeting. So,
okay, I was just curious if there's been any conversation as far as what they might think if this
right.
goes through.
No, that's a good question. I think
Phil
had a conversation with Lori. Actually, she reached out to him when I was in Florida, and not putting in her word, which
is why I didn't say anything.
Down Warren, we do not support what they're
going back to the original comment, right? I mean, tomorrow's vote of the town warrant is not, it's not the end all be all. It's not, you know, it's not the end of the world. I think it's beneficial for the residents of the town to understand, you know, the support that our select board is giving the school committee and the school district, or the lack thereof.
Okay. I also want to make it, we keep saying town of Warren, which I understand that, but I do want to make it clear, at least from my perspective, that if you look at the article, it's written from the Board of Selectmen. I don't know, yes, they're the head committee for the town, but I don't know if they're really speaking for everybody who's working over there from the town of Warren from that perspective. So, I mean, I would not that necessarily paint that broad brush for everything. I would keep it from the name that's on the article.
Yeah.
Because obviously they control the Warren and how it's run. So I would just.
That's a good point. No. I mean, I say town of Warren because it's the town of Warren, the town meeting. It's not speaking as behalf of the members. I mean, listen, I'm a resident of the town of Warren, and I absolutely don't support this. You know, so. Usually takes like an hour to get through the omnibus budget, but you know, it might not this time, right? So, if they have any questions. So. All right, so go ahead.
Thanks, Chris.
Just one other question about the busing for next year. One of the vendors reached out and asked if we were going to renew the contract for next year. Of course, I didn't really know how to answer that.
So I think that's going to be on the agenda for next week, for the regularly scheduled full school committee meeting. But yeah, I mean, I think, outside of any of that, we'll discuss it next week. So.
All right. I also forwarded the contract from the transportation study, just
okay.
For your just to be
yep. Okay. Yeah, I saw. I saw that. So. Okay. So we have a couple other things to discuss, but you know, we don't normally have a crowd, so I will open it up to anybody that has any questions or comments. Just identify who you are and where you're from, and if you have any questions, feel free to ask. If you're just here to listen, that's fine too. But I want to give you guys the opportunity. I mean, I know I'm looking out there. I see residents of the town more, so I know that you guys do have a financial interest in this as well. You know, so if anybody has any questions or comments or anything that they want to ask, go right ahead.
Have you figured out, so what, in order for us to be level serviced, is the budget that you asked for from the town, is the last number that you gave, is that completely level service, or did it include a few extra positions?
So were you going to talk about, so the budget that the school committee voted on.
Mm-hmm. The one that school committee voted on has the extra positions of the tech teacher to be shared between the two elementary schools, the health teacher between the two elementary schools, the curriculum coordinator, one for each school. Also has some special ed teachers in there also. So this budget, which was $5,021,523 for Warren and $5,031,465 for West Brookfield, does have those positions that were needs, not wishes, in it. If, you know, those positions were to be taken out of that, it would be a decrease of 600,000.
Anybody else? All right, so Jay, you want to talk about, you want that one?
Sure.
Yeah. So, obviously, with this, the one thing that strikes me as odd is the inability for the townspeople to, you know, say their piece and vote the way they feel. One of the things that did come up in the meeting when we met with the towns was the concept of making sure all the information was out there and that people have be educated enough to make a decision and do what they need to do, and whatever votes. I mean, that's democracy. Sometimes you win, sometimes you lose. But at least from this perspective, it seems like that concept is not being allowed for some of the townspeople. So one of the concepts was thinking about was if it's a making a motion at the beginning of the town meeting to bring the budget back into the omnibus budget and go from there. I know I wasn't sure exactly how a motion like that would necessarily be written up or presented, but that would be something that at one point I had thought about. This was a brainstorm concept.
I don't think you can do it. I don't think you take an action to do it back.
I thought there was some talk about that.
You can.
You can do that.
I talked to our legal counsel today. So you can, we have the option to ask for the school district to be moved back into the omnibus budget. That would be based on past practice, right? We do have that option. I don't know if it's a favorable option for us. Personally, I'm kind of leaning towards voting no for what's proposed.
Yeah, do we really want to go through that? Because we're not going to accept that money, that amount anyway.
Right.
So we better vote no and we'll just end it.
Right. I think there's going to be a lot of conversations between, you know, us, legal counsel, state ethics, you know, over the next couple months. So,
I really think voting no is going to cause more than a lot of trouble.
I believe it will too, but I'm gonna reach out to legal counsel and schedule time to talk to them tomorrow and get that all firmed up. So,
if that's the way they want to do it.
My question is, if we vote no, how much disruption will that cause for teachers, the earning their jobs, and what's going to happen next year? And what would be the period of time that we would have to wait until we could come back and address the money that we do need? Because even if we go to at least 112, if it gets that high, then there's no money. Have to lay teachers off because there'd be no money in the budget to continue paying that until we, you know, it's only 112 you're going to get.
You just don't have your votes mental. You'll have enough to get through a few months to do that. You won't get through a whole year.
No. The pay that teachers would get, unless they have a summer position, the pay that they would, I don't know how it works, some districts space it out over the summer and some give a lump sum. But those are part of this year's budget anyways. So teachers who work this school year would still be paid.
It depends if they take the 26 pay period schedule or some of them.
But either way.
It comes out of this year's budget, right. And I know the first couple of pays, if it is after July 1st, it's still out of this year's budget, but it's a carryover. It's a 10,001 account instead of a 10,000 account. So, but I know, I think to Maury's point, I think the administration needs to make the determination of staff levels by, you know, I think it's June 15th or something like that. So moving forward, that's the time it needs to be taking place. I'm not sure when West Brookfield's town meeting is. 15th.
It's often set on a time schedule of 20, doesn't it, whatever, so many days to do it, so many days to do it, so many days.
Right.
But to come back to what you were saying, right, by June 15th, doesn't the school have to say, well, you have a job next year or not? I mean, I think that's in the contract, they have to say.
Yes.
So there's gonna be possibly a lot of pink slips happening, unfortunately.
Right.
So.
There's no answer.
I mean, we do have representation from the union. I don't know if you have any comments on that. I mean.
Or if you're just here as a resident, you can just be here as a resident. We're here as taxpayers first and foremost. So, you know, if you want to just be a taxpayer, you can be a.
I mean, if you have to plan to cut all those positions, you have to plan it by June 15th. And there's parameters in place, there's step-by-step process on how to do it, and you need to start working.
I think that's, you know, that's pretty much where we stand.
Can you refresh my memory? Who are the selectmen in Warren right now?
So right now it's David Dufresne, it's Rich Eihacker, and it's Derek Ruiz. I believe Mr. Dufresne was just reelected this past week. So
he's the chair.
He is the chair, yes.
So
David Dufresne.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
Tina Edison, I work here as an ELA teacher. Just a question, if you vote down this article in Warren, then what? What happens? What do they need to do? I know you're talking about turmoil and, you know, what does it cause, and then what would the next step be, and what might the timeline be? I know you might not know, but do you have any idea?
So that's what the legal counsel.
I'm thinking time-wise, huh?
That's what the call the legal counsel is going to
okay.
figure out. What are the next steps? How does the process work? You know, is there a timeline? I know, you know, from the final point of say we do not approve the budgets that get voted on the towns, it's a 45-day window for the towns to reschedule another meeting. So. But I don't know about like a no vote, what that does for the timeline or not.
So everyone's talking about voting no and stuff, and we're assuming that we can't make the change. You said we can. Do we want to jump right to the no vote, or should we at least try to amend it to the number that makes sense for us first? And it's I would say, in my opinion, would be the bubble service, right? With that, from that perspective, and we show from that perspective, and if we have that, then that's now probably our high water mark. So I'm just, from that perspective, I'm just people's thoughts.
So well, to kind of watch how the town meeting has played out the last couple of years, my biggest fear would be that someone would amend the amendment, you open a can of worms by doing that, right? And someone would amend the amendment to potentially this earth-shattering number. I think the end, the way that this plays out is that we're gonna end up on a 1/12 budget and have a district-wide meeting. Because if the school committee approved budget or something very close to it doesn't get approved, right? Because we're kind of at this tipping point in our districts where we literally can't have any more cuts. There is nothing, there's nothing left, or very little left.
So from where I'm sitting, now I agree what you're saying, but what I'm saying is that if we try to amend it and nothing happens, we're still in the same spot if we say no.
Right.
All roads lead to the same location, except for if the number that we ask for gets changed and gets voted in. And in that scenario, the way I see it is that though that's now our high water mark, and in years past, past when something like that has happened, West Brookfield could come in underneath it, and then we could vote West Brookfield's number or something on that time, and then because Warren's number was above, it's an automatic a yes vote.
Reduction.
So there's that concept of streamlining on that concept from that perspective. Now, I don't say we go in and if we can get amended, don't go for anything other than level service or where we are today. I think that's for discussion from you guys. But we're assuming, right, part of this discussion is the assumption is that we can amend it. What if we can? What's the objective?
So I know we can always, you know, we can always, like, I forget the terminology, you know, basically recall the, you know, the article.
Sure.
And I believe we can recall it with a higher number. We did reach out to, you know, our friends at the State House who spoke to, you know, legal counsel through the state, and they basically informed us that the moderator does have the ultimate power, the ultimate say as to how the meeting goes. So from what I understand, the moderator can say no.
Yes.
So it I believe is something worth having. If it can happen, I agree to your point, Jay. We have a higher number, and then, you know, say West Brookfield comes in at, you know, say 40% of that number, you know, we approve the West Brookfield portion of it, it rolls down to Warren, and Warren just has a deduction in their assessment, and it goes back to their omnibus for their E&D money for next year. I mean, there's obviously a lot of questions and a lot of time going to be spent with legal counsel tomorrow to get these things answered. So
it's just one of those things, and what, you know, the concept of, though maybe it's unlikely, that scenario maybe saves pink slips from going out and stuff along those lines and secures some certain stuff. So that was the thought process behind that.
It's kind of one of those things where doesn't hurt to try necessarily.
Right.
I think you're going to know when you walk into the town meeting just by seeing who's there, whether you have that chance or not. I think that decision should probably be made then.
Absolutely. But we should have that documentation in case it is fatal.
Right.
Prepare for it doesn't mean we have to act on it.
And know what the number is.
Right.
Right.
Travis, you got all that?
Yeah.
Up to speed. There you go. Ryan was new last year. He said, he just said, I feel your pain. All right. Any other questions? Any other comments? Any other concerns? We don't really have any budget update. We just discussed it. So. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious about the town meeting, what the above minimum that was voted on last year. I don't remember at the town meeting.
So
there's
the above
a lot
minimum that was voted on last year for the town of Warren was $523,142. So they're looking to take $113,000 out of that. Yes. Yes, sir.
Hi, Ray Pagano, town of Warren resident. So last year, you guys asked for numbers that did not get approved by the towns. It was just very rough numbers, $500,000 under what the budget request was. How did that deficit from what you were asking get covered?
So we used the ESSER money, which was the federal funded, you know, I forget what ESSER stands for. So that's how we made it that shortfall.
Okay.
And then some of the positions that, you know, we just discussed earlier today, you know, social workers and, you know, basically, you know, teachers and employees to help our
went down by 1.0 at the high school. So there were, across the board, there were some cuts that took place.
There were two positions eliminated, and then ESSER funds were used.
Art and gym.
There was also some teachers who retired.
And there were teachers that were retired and weren't replaced, and music went down to, instead of a 2.0, it went down to a 1.0 equivalent. And then we were able to use some funds from the social emotional learning grant to help pay for an adjustment counselor, which was one of the things that they had asked to add to the budget this year. As you can imagine, social emotional learning, the difficulty kids are coming in to with us when they're younger now, even the older kids. Those were things that we had that the recommendation from the school committee that we had. We were able to fund some of that through a grant last year, but this year that grant's no longer there.
So your budget this year to be level service is $2 million plus more than last year. Is that a fair statement?
Roughly.
Roughly.
Yeah. It includes like $1 million of one-time funds that we were forced to use last year because
of the budget. Okay, wait a minute. Hold on. This is what I want to get to.
Yes.
Like, so, were you forced to use it last year?
Absolutely.
Or did you choose to use it last year?
Well, it was either that or we cut $1 million.
Okay. I understand. That's what we're here. That's what the dispute is about.
Right.
Is that you were told by the towns last year and in other years that no, we're not willing to fund the school to this level that's being requested. Is it not incumbent on the school then to adjust to that reality and not use one-time funds for ongoing budgetary expenses?
That's about a year's worth of meetings to answer that question.
But fundamentally, you understand my concept.
I sat in a year's worth of meetings.
Okay.
I understand the concept.
Okay. Okay. And so, a term was used this evening that a earth-shattering number that the Warren Selectman had put on the article is being looked at. Could anyone on this committee be willing to appreciate that for Warren, and between the two towns, 2 million, for Warren, 1.2 rounding off, is also an earth-shattering number to the town? Anyone willing to accept that?
Absolutely. I'll
okay,
that.
Okay, great. That's I appreciate that. Because one of the problems
it wasn't as earth-shattering as you would expect, though, if you saw this building over the last 7-8 years the way that many of us have, it's not as earth-shattering, because this has been building and building and building and building and building. Last year, when we had to make the tough decision to use ESSER funds, we had to use the other one-time funds, we had to make that decision. That was a tough decision. It's either we keep this school going and use one-time funds, or we knock the legs out from under all these kids in this school. That's the decision we had to make. And that was building for like 7 years. And so when we get hit with a number this year, I wouldn't say it's earth-shattering, because I saw this coming 5 years ago.
Right.
This is all old news. None of this is earth-shattering to me.
Right. So when, just for example, if a fire truck or fire equipment needs to be purchased, and the chief throws out
Wait, excuse me. I'm sorry to cut you off, but can we not try and pit one department against another?
No,
that's
I'm not.
That's
saying,
not fair to do.
In no way do I intend to pit. This is not about pitting. It's simply saying.
To your point, though, it's like we'll use the fire department because they have an article on the floor for funds for self-contained breathing apparatus.
Right.
The town puts money aside to the fire stabilization account, where they then transfer that money to the department. They do it for many departments throughout the town of Warren. They do not do that for the school department. The school department comes out of the omnibus budget up until last year, up until this year, because last year it was still part of the omnibus budget, it was only the above minimum that it took out. So it's apples and oranges. It's,
Can I respond to that?
Yes, sir.
And this is not a fire department versus school debate, so just to satisfy that concern. The above minimum contribution is the equivalent, that's the analogy to the stabilization for fire equipment. The chief purposely didn't ask for that money all at once. You guys ask for it because the way this process is set up, every year you ask for that extra. The above minimum contribution is the extra. That's that, the state says you should be able to operate on this amount. If you can't, you can come to the town. The town, we could give you $8 million, we could give you $20 million, we could give, well, except for the limits, of course. But when we give you that extra $500,000 plus that we've given you for the last 3 years, that's your fire equipment money.
No, it's not.
Why not?
That's not extra. It's, you would have to understand the way that Title 70 works. You'd have to understand the inner workings of a broken system in order to equate that to, that's extra. That's, it's not extra. This is what we need to have to operate this school.
Your issue is with the state, not with the town. The town has been generous. The town's given you, okay, well, all right, that's what tomorrow will say.
That's,
is how generous or not the town's gonna be.
And I think everybody on this committee understands that it's not a town issue, it's not a school issue, it's a state issue. And I've been saying that for 14 years,
yep,
that the state system is broken. We historically get a $30 increase per student.
Right.
$30. Do you know how much it costs to run the district? $21 million. You know how much more we get from the state? $30,000. $30,000 doesn't even cover the cost of the electricity increase for next year. Our electric bill went up $146,000 for next year. The Chapter 70 increase doesn't cover that. So we have that, we have special education tuition, we have contractual obligations through the transportation company that we have Medicaid, we have salaries, all of that comes to millions of dollars. $30,000 does not cover that millions of dollars of increases that we're contractually obligated to give. The teachers in the town, in the Quaboag district, are some of the lowest paid teachers in the area. And we've been saying this for years. The town of Warren went through this whole reclassification of all the town's employees and rechanged all the classifications and gave everybody big fat raises.
It wasn't big,
you know. Well, it was more than 3%. Okay. It was more than 2%. I sit on the negotiation team with the union, and I will tell you this, it is far from a pleasant experience because we feel that they deserve more money than they get, but we can't give it to them because the town doesn't back the increases that we propose to the town. So,
right.
Again,
but
we're in the same situation.
They're proposals. You're not entitled to that extra money. You can request it. You can request it, but as a committee, don't sit here and act as if the town has not been generous. The town has been. $1.2 million for Warren is the entire police budget and
again, now you're pitting police against the school. That's not what we're here for. We're here to talk about the school budget based upon.
I'm not pitting departments. I'm contextualizing the amounts of money involved here.
You can't compare the school districts and the amount of employees in the school district and the amount of operating costs and the amount of residents of Warren and Westbrookfield that we service and the police department. Each service is important and we need both of them, and the schools need to support the police and the police go above and beyond in supporting our schools, but you cannot compare them. They're two different, very different.
I'm not comparing them.
Can I?
I'm saying that 1.2 million.
This has turned into a debate, not public comments.
1.2 million above the minimum contribution for Warren is an immense increase, and if all you're doing is level servicing, how can that be? It's not all from inflation.
Come to meetings and find out.
I've tried to go to some meetings,
and they've been canceled to try to discuss these matters.
I'm here every month.
I've gone to budget committee meetings where they've been canceled because of lack of people showing up. So don't go down there. I've been going for seven years.
Has never been canceled.
I appreciate your comments, sir.
All right.
You know,
and I appreciate your time. I've been to a number of recent meetings.
You have. Last couple months.
I'm responding to his comment.
No,
I respond. Excuse me a minute. I'm responding to his comment to me.
Right.
If you want to correct someone from speaking out of turn, please correct your committee member.
Understood. And I just said you have been attending the last few meetings. We see you in the audit. It's we know you've been coming to the last few meetings, but this has been an ongoing issue with the school for years.
I understand.
Yeah.
I've been involved,
and we've been fighting with the state for years to try to get that formula fixed. And unfortunately, we live outside of 128. We live outside of 495, and it falls on deaf ears when it comes to the state.
Mr. Schwick, I'd like to say, in all fairness, I want to say something, one more thing. I've said it in other public forums, I'll say it here.
Last pass.
I would love to give you $1.2 million as a Warren resident if that money was used to hire a legal team to sue the state. I sympathize with your position, don't get me wrong. We're on opposite sides of this dispute.
Absolutely.
Okay, I don't mean any disrespect. I'm being earnest. I'm simply saying there's other perspectives. Please don't bring to the town an attitude of entitlement that if we don't give you the full 1.2 that you're asking for from Warren, that somehow the town is being something less than generous to the school. That's just not the case. I sympathize with your situation. Your issue is with the state. I would support. If it was me, well, it's not me, but you should get every school district west of 128, and you should all go to the state house, and you should go to the DESE headquarters, and you should all say, we're done with your mandates. We're not doing them. What would happen? I know that's a crazy idea. I know it's not realistic. But boy, would I love to see it. I'd be there with you.
I'll be quiet. We'll try to organize that.
It'd be great.
All right. Thank you. Anybody else?
Talk to Representative Smola about the Rural Aid Formula. There has been already a commission that has come out with a report that does state that the Rural Formula is wrong. So I was involved in the Urban Formula and was one of the people that got the Student Opportunity Act in. And when we did it, we did it to benefit 128 communities, not knowing the situation for rural education. So because of the low-income formula and the high-needs formula being down lower, you don't get the large amount of money that the 128 communities got for the SOA. So we have been working this year, talking to people about changing the SOA formula, but we're told we cannot change it because that was a very long process and that formula is not going to change. What we could do is get the rural aid formula changed. So it would be like a SOA for rural school districts. So there is an amendment that Todd and several other people had put in Gobi, quite a few other people that are state reps and senators put in. But the latest on that is not favorable because the rurals across the state, still some of them have saved their money from the ESSER. And so because there is still money out in ESSER for these rurals, and the rurals are all seen together, not as individual communities, they don't feel that the amendment is going to pass this year for the increase in the rural aid. So there is movement going on. It's just that I don't think this year, while there's still funding, ESSER funding that other rurals have not used, that's going to go forward. But you're right, and it has been proven now, there's a report, and the reason why the Urbans got it is because we were going to sue the state. And it was a very organized movement, and it was Brockton, New Bedford, Springfield, and Worcester that had that happen. But it was a lawsuit that was going to the state, and that's how that did come about.
Four districts that carry a lot more weight in the state than Warren, Westbrookfield,
yes.
Palmer, Ware, whatever, so. All right, that being said, I thank you guys for